Our scripture lesson this morning is from the Gospels, from a passage found only in Luke. Luke chapter 19, the first 10 verses. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through, and behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. And he was seeking to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not because he was small in stature. So he ran on ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was about to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today." And so he hurried and came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they all grumbled, "He has gone to be the guest of a man who is a sinner." And Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, "Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I will give to the poor, and if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will restore it fourfold." And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, since he also is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Okay, just because it's true that I always found this song to be true, and I always sing it at a charity or event because it's important that you remember this. It's not everything, but it changes. Here we go.
That was Cyndi Lauper. Those performances were about 40 years apart. Cyndi was very popular in the early 80s. She was 30 years old. She released her first album, which is one of the best-selling albums the whole decade. She had a quirky style and an amazing voice that could actually span four octaves in perfect pitch. But some of you may not remember her from then, but may remember her from her later appearances on The Apprentice in 2010. I have to say, it's nice to see a rock and roller who knows how to age gracefully. But it's interesting to think about this song and her role in that show. I mean, after all, what was The Apprentice all about, right? Money and power. You know, we read all the old mythologies about the ancient world, where gods were the personification of earthly powers and desires. We find stories of precocious gods who toyed with humans, who sought their favor and support. We put the book down and we think these ancient people were foolish and primitive. And then we turn on our TV and we watch something like The Apprentice and we realize that we're somehow not all that different. Money and power are still our idols. We just worship them in different ways. Let me start with a few comments on money and God in general. I think everyone understands that money and greed are some of the greatest problems in life. and that the Bible speaks more about money than about any other purely earthly topic. But I think that when we talk about money in church, mentally a lot of us put our fingers in our ears and, you know, go la, 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 because we're afraid of what we're going to hear. In fact, Tim Keller notes that when he first did a series on idols, fewer people came to the sermon on greed than all the others. And he thinks it's basically because, not that we're not concerned about greed might be a problem in our life, but we're worried that how much God might show us that it is. And I think we worry that what God really wants us to do is to give all our money away, sell our possessions, then live in rags in a cave. So we tune out discussions about money in church because we think God will ask us to go too far and ask too much. So let me say up front what I've said from the start of this series, that the most powerful and destructive idols in our lives are mostly good things, but good only if they're kept in their proper place in our hearts and in our lives. Especially in the Old Testament, financial success was seen as a blessing from God. There's nothing wrong with having enough money to live a modest and secure lifestyle in which we use our money wisely, work hard for it, and especially when we use some of it as a blessing to others and to advance the kingdom of God. The problem is that for many reasons, money is one of our most common idols, even if we're unaware of it. And I think Keller is right. He says, greed hides itself from the victim. Greed hides itself so deeply that no one should be confident that it is not a problem for them. He goes on, why can't anyone in the grip of greed see it? The counterfeit god of money uses powerful psychological and sociological dynamics. Everyone tends to live in a particular socioeconomic bracket. Once you're able to afford to live in a particular neighborhood, send your kids to its schools, participate in its social life, you'll find yourself surrounded by quite a number of people who have more money than you. You don't compare yourself to the rest of the world. You compare yourself to those in your bracket. And the human heart always wants to justify itself. And one of the easiest ways is to say, I don't live as well as him or her. My means are modest compared to theirs. You can reason and think like that no matter how lavishly you're living. As a result, most Americans think of themselves as middle class, and only 2% call themselves upper class. But the rest of the world is not fooled. When people visit here from other parts of the globe, they are staggered to see the level of materialistic comfort the majority of Americans have come to view as a necessity. I remember as a kid visiting the house of a friend of mine whose dad was a dentist. They had a big house, and this kid had his own room, one he didn't have to share with a sibling. And I thought to myself, this family's rich. I now live in a house about that size. My kids had their own rooms, and I don't consider myself rich. But it's all a matter of perspective, isn't it? I used to do mission trips to the Navajo Reservation, and there at the church at Canyon de Chelly, they had an apartment built into the church for the pastor. It was modest by our standard, a kitchen, a living room, three small bedrooms, and 1.5 baths. Almost every Navajo who visited them said the same thing. Wow, you must be rich. Pastor Keller introduces an important idea in what we're studying this week. It's the idea of deep idols, and it's a little complicated, but I think, practically when I read his comments, it was one of the most important things for me to understand. I want to unpack it a bit. To quote Keller, he says this. He says, we should consider that counterfeit gods come in clusters, making the idolatric structure of the heart complex. There are deep idols within the surface beneath the more concrete and visible surface idols that we serve. Sin in our heart affects our basic motivational desires, so they become idolatrous, deep idols. Some people are strongly motivated by a desire for influence and power, while others are more excited by approval and appreciation. Some want emotional and physical comfort more than anything else, while others still want security and control of their environment. People with the deep idol of power do not mind being unpopular to gain influence. People who are most motivated by approval are the opposite. They will gladly lose power and control as long as everybody thinks well of them. Each deep idol, power, approval, comfort, and control, generates a different set of fears and a different set of hopes. Surface idols are the things such as money, our spouse, our children, through which our deep idol seeks to find fulfillment. Now, I have to say, I think Keller is definitely onto something. He identifies deep idols, power, approval, comfort, and control, and you could argue that there are more, but this is certainly enough to understand the concept. You may seem to understand worship a surface idol like money, but it's your deep idol that you're really trying to satisfy. And depending on what that deep idol is, you will handle and view money in different ways. If it's power, you might worship money because having lots of money gives you control over people around you. And frankly, that's the motif you saw personalized in Donald Trump and The Apprentice. Money that allows you to control others. If your deep idol is approval, you may worship money because you can use it to buy things that make you popular and popular. The right clothes, car, house, plastic surgery, whatever. The list is endless. If your deepest motivation is comfort, money will be the tool that you buy the comforts with. And so you'll be motivated to seek more money for the ever-expanding worldly comforts you seek. And if it's control is your deep idol, you want to control your life, and the best way to do that is to have a lot of money. So you seek money, and it looks to everyone else in the world that that is what you worship, when deep down inside, you seek to have complete control over your life, and money is the means to that control. And now the truth is that none of these idols really give what they promise. I will tell you that I have known a few truly rich people, and they are no happier than people of modest means, and quite frankly, they are often really screwed up and have really screwed up families. They may have power, but almost everyone in their lives have love-hate relationships with them. They may have friends, but their friendships are often bought and paid for, and they have the inner dissatisfaction of knowing that. They may have comfort, but all of that can be taken away in a moment. Remember Bernie Madoff and the people who invested their life savings with him? Ask them if that's not the case. And they may have control, but you can read thousands of stories of people who had everything they could ever want, and one single event happened to take that all away from them. I don't know if any of you watched a few years ago the miniseries Klondike. It was loosely based on the true account of real people. Interesting enough, one powerful, strong, rich woman in the story, Belinda Mulrooney, who's played by a much better looking woman on the series, was a real person who made several fortunes. She lived lavishly. She lived securely. And oddly enough, she wound up settling in Yakima. And she built a mansion that's still there. You may have seen it before. But she ran out of money. And she ended her life penniless. And she had to work as a house cleaner. Like all such counterfeit gods, in the end, her idol failed her. And if these idols don't seem to fail here on earth, they will fail miserably on the day we stand before God and our hearts are revealed as God sees who we really have worshipped during our life. As Paul said in Romans, they exchanged the truth of God for a lie. They worship and serve created things rather than the Creator, who is forever praised. Amen. Now again, the way to deal with any idol in our life is not simply to try and do better. There may be things we can and need to do to reprioritize in our lives, and that'll be helpful and important, but they will always be insufficient to change us at the deepest level. As we've said before, the trick to taming the power money has over us is not simply to love money less, but to love God more. Keller points us to someone who had a problem with money and overcame it. It's a guy with a funny name, Zacchaeus, which oddly enough means pure or innocent. Luke's the only gospel that tells us this story, and it really fits Luke's desire to include fallen people who are saved by turning to Jesus. It happens down in Jericho, very possibly when Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem the week before the crucifixion. Jericho is at a major crossroads, being the place where people cross the Jordan from the east and those from the north and south who turned west from there to head up to Jerusalem. A good freshwater spring supplied both people and agriculture and is even used today for both. Of course, all this commerce meant money was to be made and taxed, and it was a place where a tax collector could make a lot of money. Now, we've talked about tax collectors, so I won't labor the story, but there were Jews who were hired by the Romans to collect taxes in the region. Rome told them how much money Rome expected, and anything they collected above that they could keep for themselves. So the more they ripped off their own people, with Roman soldiers backing them up, the more money they made. And of course, they were hated by the Jews with a unique passion. And Zacchaeus was not merely a tax collector. The text tells us he was a, I always mispronounced it, Archetelones, pretty close, right? Which is a chief or our head tax collector. He's probably the guy who made the deal with the Romans and hired the other tax collectors to do the dirty work. So he is both the most hated tax collector and the one who gains the most. And I got to say, actually, I think there's one of the key reasons he climbs the tree is not merely to make it easier to see Jesus, but because the small, despised guy is pressing in with a crowd of people who justifiably hated him. And he probably knew that mixing in with them in a crowd was not safe. So in the process, Jesus does his normal, do something no one would have guessed. And he invites Zacchaeus, himself, to Zacchaeus' house for dinner. Something that would have been considered a great honor for Zacchaeus. And it must have absolutely infuriated the people who came out to see him. Now Luke didn't tell us what Jesus said to him. But the implication is that this wasn't just a lecture about honesty or fair taxation. Jesus drew Zacchaeus to himself. And the result is what? His salvation is something that does not come simply because you're generous with your money or sorry about how you earned it. No, it only comes because you made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior. And what the story showed is not that Jesus made Zacchaeus generous or that he convinced him to be honest, but that Zacchaeus came to worship Jesus on the inside more than he worshiped money, or perhaps even deeper, more than he worshiped the comfort and control that money gave him. He overcame a counterfeit God the only way you really can, by replacing it with the one true God. Keller puts it this way: Jesus gave up all his treasures in heaven in order to make you his treasure, for you are a treasured people, 1 Peter. And when you see him dying to make you his treasure, that will make him yours. Money will cease to be the currency of your significance and security, and you will want to bless others with what you have. To the degree that you grasp the gospel, money will have no dominion over you. Think on his costly grace until it changes you into a generous people. The solution to stinginess is reorientation to the generosity of Christ in the gospel, how he poured out his wealth for you. So now you don't have to worry about money. The cross proves God's care for you and gives you security. You don't have to envy anybody else's money. Jesus' love and salvation confer on you a remarkable status, one that money cannot give you. Money cannot save you from tragedy or give you control in a chaotic world. Only God can do that. And what breaks the power of money over us is not just redoubled effort to follow the example of Christ. Rather, it is deepening your understanding in the salvation of Christ, what you have in him, and then living out the changes that that understanding makes in your heart, the seat of your mind, your will, and your emotions. One final note this morning. Mark, Luke, and Matthew all record Jesus saying, "It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." Now, we in the church don't like to offend rich people, so we tend to spiritualize or downplay these words. We shouldn't, because I think Jesus meant it. And to be honest, that's just about everyone here, including me. We probably fit into that rich category if we look at it in the grand scope of the world. Every study on personal giving shows that on a percentage basis, poor people give away more than rich people. As you rise in income, you give away smaller proportions of what you have. One would think that as you get more money, you have less to hold on to. It actually seems the reverse is the case. So friends, don't let money control you. Don't let your deep idols misdirect you. Make only one thing your goal in life, and that's to respond to the love of Jesus Christ. Paul wrote to his beloved disciple and church leader Timothy this: "Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. In this way, they will lay up a treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life." Let's pray. Father, thank you for reminding us that money and greed are so easy idols to become idols in our life. But even then, they represent things that are even deeper: desire for power, for control, for comfort. And we ask that you would not only help us to root those things out and understand them, but replace them with only one thing, and that's your Son, Jesus Christ. For if we truly love and worship him above all other things, that's and only then when everything else falls into place. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for this morning. Bless our hearts and our minds. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, if God has spoken to you this morning in a unique way, then I would pray that you would follow his words and follow his tugging at your hearts and turn fully to him and to share that with a fellow Christian who you trust. We now receive the benediction, friends. Go from this place to follow the King who is with you every day, giving our lives to him. May his grace, his mercy, his peace, and his blessing be with you now and forevermore. Amen.